Hello everyone, Treeks here. Welcome to my newest Let's Play. Welcome to Donkey Kong. What? I hear you say? Again Donkey Kong? Yeah, again Donkey Kong. This is indeed, like the title might say, a remake of the very first Donkey Kong. Only it's officially a remake, because you might see this in a moment already. This is much, much, much more than just a remake of the original game. The original game I already covered on my channel, of course. You might know, not per se because of my Let's Play of it, but because of Donkey Kong in general, you might know that's a pretty short, early 80s arcade platformer. Pretty simplistic. However, Nintendo, more than 10 years after the original game came out, decided on their handheld system, the Game Boy, to re-release this game, however, in a very, very, very big expanded way. This game is much, much, much more than just the original game. The original game is of course still present in this. It is however just a teensy-weensy tip of the iceberg in this game. While the introduction screen rolls, you might see some introduction to the mechanics of this game. Mario is trying to show off how things work out in this game with his new movements, his new jump sets. Like I said, this is much more than the original game, because you might not recognize that from the original game. True, it's not in there. This game expanded it by a lot. Where the original game was a pretty simple, simplistic platformer. As you can see here, this is of course the Game Boy rendition of it, but it is still recognizable as the original Donkey Kong, with the barrel rolling and the hammer and everything, and Mario jumping and trying to save his girlfriend Pauline. This is of course a game that takes place pretty early in the lore when it comes to the Mario universe. Mario is not yet a resident of the Mushroom Kingdom. There's no Princess Toadstool or Peach present yet. Mario has a different girlfriend, Pauline. That's one thing that does not change from the original game. The story is the same. However, as you may see in this map screen already, there are a lot of new designed levels with a lot of new mechanics present, making this game feel completely different than its original. Speaking of which, the original. Let's get started with that original. Let's finally push start. I always try to keep a little story before I start with my project. If you didn't know, there's always a little background story going with these games. Let's of course just go for file 1. Usually I go for file 3 when some files are present, but I usually don't do it when I do it on a new game selection. Right, this is a part we know. Donkey Kong kidnaps Pauline. Already tripping over my words again. And we are going to have to save her. This level we know. Good old 25M. We get the hammer. We can throw the hammer up, so we can take it to a new level with us. Hammer automatically destroys everything, so not going to bother too much with these early levels. Or in the original game, you might say, all of the levels. This first one, we know, is nothing too special. Right, 50M. This is actually a level I did not cover in the original project I did, because when I played the original Donkey Kong, I actually played the NES version of it. And I mentioned it then, in the NES version. But this cake factory, I believe this is officially a cake factory, is actually not present in the NES version. Still don't know why. Let's get the 1-up over here. We might need it. Oh, conveyor belts change direction. So, even though I have covered the original project, this is actually a new level for that. Nothing too special, of course, but still, we haven't seen this level yet. Don't worry, we'll see it later. There's more renditions of the original Donkey Kong coming up later, where you do see it in its original shape and form. Right, let's get back to where we do know things. 75M. This is considered the hardest level in the original game. Right, keep in mind, this is also already present in the original game, but Mario has fall damage in this game. This is not a traditional platformer in the sense that you can just jump from anywhere you want. There's actually a certain height where you can fall off, and if you do, you get stunned before you are able to move. And if you fall from even higher than that, you even die. The rest of this game, the new part of this game, quote-unquote, is actually going to make a lot of use of that. But before we start talking about the new game, let's first get rid of this old game. One up. Don't really need the hammer. There's one more over there. Oh! Apparently you can do it like that. Then I'll do it like this. I was pretty sure you could just walk over those beams and double back and it would still count. Well, lesson number one for this game. That does not work. Right, let's get rid of this. And hey, if this were the original game, we would have been done already. But no. This time around, it's not going to be that easy. DK is not going to let himself be defeated this easily this time around. The four original stages have been cleared. And the number of seconds remaining, that's what the scores you get at the end of the game, or end of any world, they get tallied up to a total which can give you 1-ups. For every 100 seconds remaining, 1-up, and for every seconds after that, you still get an additional 1-up. So, 294 seconds in my case gives me 3 1-ups. Even 201 seconds remaining would have been 3 1-ups, that's how it works. Alright, and then we see that with clearing what originally was the original game, was just the introduction. That was just World Zero, you might say. This is where it actually gets started. The first world is Big City. Got a glimpse of this course in the introduction screen already. Right, first thing we get introduced to, the introduction screen for this world did this. If you press B on certain objects, you can pick them up and you can throw them. You can use this on enemies, or you can even do it with enemies to get rid of them. Watch out for the oil here, because that's gonna be death. You've seen something like this in stage 4, the 100M stage. And you see it here as well. There are actually a couple of enemies that react to you whenever you pick up the hammer. In this case, they start running faster. I shouldn't have killed that enemy, because there's actually, starting from World 1, 3 collectibles you can get in any level. A hat, a purse, and an umbrella. And as you can see, those technically count as collectibles. I don't really consider them part of the 100% business, so I think I'm not going to bother with them every level. I'll show off getting all of them in this one, at least. Right, and this is how you clear levels from this point on. Grab the key, enter the key door. Done. Of course, we start off easy. And this is basically what getting all of the collectibles in the level do. It will give you the ability to play a bonus game. Nothing too special, actually. You can use this to grind for lives. It is pretty easy to do, so. But there's no real checklist for getting all of these objects every single level, so. It's just for getting a bonus. Right, and as you may have seen by this point, by the way, the mechanics of this game get introduced and everything. This game, unlike the original, actually starts becoming not just a platformer, but actually starts becoming a puzzle platformer. Every single level again, we get a couple of puzzles we need to solve in order to reach the end, in order to reach the door, in order to reach the key, and therefore the door. Not really too easily recognizable at first, because of it being so early, we of course first get introduced to how things work, but eventually they go all out when it comes to puzzling. These early levels are pretty straightforward. Pretty neat round, 100 seconds remaining. Right, next bonus. Of course, we're not going to have that same roulette bonus every single time we clear a level with everything. Of course, they made more bonuses than that. This was also one of them. Even though this one was a little bit less successful, but still. Usually, I'm not really too shy about lives in this game, so I'm going to assume I don't really need them. Would be nice if I actually do need them, because that would mean this let's play would become a little bit more exciting because of... Apparently those things don't die if you throw an enemy at them. But the hammer does. Come on, guys. I want Pauline's hat. Because, yeah, I didn't really explain it yet. No matter, I can do it now. But all of the objects you are collecting, you might recognize them as ladies' stuff. That is not a coincidence. We are actually rounding up Pauline's belongings that she dropped along the way while being kidnapped by Donkey Kong. Ooh, you can duck. So use that if you think those sparks are a little bit scary. Right, you can cheese this a little bit. The game hasn't officially learned us this trick yet, but if you press the jump button while holding down, you can actually do a handstand. And while in handstand, you can actually jump a little bit higher than you normally can. Officially, the game wants you to jump on the moving platform and through that go up the upper platform, but you don't have to. There's a trick you can use. And that is not cheating, because the game is going to teach us that trick later. Just the fact that it hasn't taught us the trick yet does not mean that we aren't allowed to use it. Yeah, two up. Right, every fourth stage, you might recognize this on the world map, but every fourth stage is actually colored in a little bit differently. You can see it on the eighth level, in comparison to level 7, 6 and 5. It's a red dot instead of a blue one. Blue. Colorblind tricks. To the rescue. It's obviously white. Just like this stage, it is red. What does red dot levels mean? That means... boss stage. Yeah, boss stage. We aren't completely rid of Donkey Kong's original format of trying to get to DK and Pauline to clear the stage. No. Not every stage has changed into grab key, go through door, stage done. These boss stages, quote-unquote boss stages for... of course, if you get knocked while climbing a ladder, you get knocked off the ladder. Jump, please. It's quite obvious you can avoid this by just jumping while he lands. That's a little bit too close to the top of the screen, so I'm going to play it safe. That's also a thing the handstands work for. If you're in handstand mode, you are pretty much immune to enemies from above, like these falling debris. It's so nice that you know tricks from later in the game that you can use early game, even though the game hasn't taught us those yet. But they will. This is actually quite fun, because this is actually the way the game teaches you all of the mechanics. Through these cutscenes you get through every fourth stage. Whenever you beat a boss level, you actually get these little cutscenes where you get taught mechanics. Like in this case, those expendable platforms that you find in levels coming from this point, of course, because they don't teach you this for nothing right now. And every time you beat the boss stage, you get a save prompt, so might as well. I still have time, it's only 15 minutes, so let's continue. And of course, we immediately get introduced to using the mechanic we just saw ourselves. Watch out for the mice, I'm pretty sure they're mice. Go away. Alright, this is how they work. The screen whitens out a little bit and you get kind of a cursor where you can select where to place these things. I'll, of course, place it right here at the start. And the timer starts running. The music you hear right now is actually a timer. Goes faster, faster, faster. And then it goes out. Of course, these blocks are not going to stay there forever. The puzzle element here is to make sure we get in time to where I don't want to handstand, I want to grab the key. Right, and the next one's obviously going to go here, so we can cross and beat the level. Easy introduction to this mechanic. Of course, they are going to do this a little bit more complicated later on, but why do complicated if you first need to learn how things work? Right, we have learned how things worked. Now start actually using it in puzzles, game. Don't worry, they will. Right, could have been worse, could have been better. Nice middle of the road. Right, stage 1-6. It's already the 10th stage I'm playing today. First video, 10 stages, hell yeah. Right, now we get introduced to these vertical ones. They're kind of the same, only difference is these go vertically, and of course, as you might guess with verticals, these are letters. We now have... I did not want to climb the ladder, I tried to press left. But apparently the game registered it as me pressing up. I need to look out how I handle my controller. Right, a really stupid death. Completely unnecessary. First, let me grab the purse. Should have done that in the first place. I want to go a little bit more to the middle so that flaming guy is not going to bother me anymore. Please get me my one up back. Right, now we need to use this to go down. Don't drop yourself from all the way up there, because like I explained earlier, falling from an extremely high height is going to kill you in this game. Right, now we need to combine the horizontal and the vertical ones. First place a horizontal one in such a position that you can reach the upper platform. And then place a ladder underneath that so you can actually reach that platform. Okay, that was pretty unfair that that guy fell with me. And I was not able to do anything about it. Apparently the game is now becoming too hard for me. I don't remember ever having died on the first world. I've already done it twice in the same level now. Let's play Curse Strikes again. This is not hard, I'm just being stupid about it. Right, from this height I can survive. There we go. See, this is not hard. Why am I trying to fail this so badly? Like I just promised, I'd like this let's play to be a little bit exciting for me to say, am I even going to make it? Not am I going to make it, but let's plays can be a little bit dull sometimes if the player ends the let's play with more than 99 lives. But hey, that's not even even that is not really that much of a bad thing, because just clearing the levels in general is challenge enough, you might say, because this is still a puzzle platformer after all, so... Just your life count is not everything about the challenge here. What the heck even happened there? I glitched off that guy and... Yeah, then he killed me. My final level, by the way, I see 20 minutes have passed already. I'm going to die every single level, am I? Got some of some funny business. And I can cheese this, by the way, by just jumping over that wall to the right. That is not high enough for me not to be able to jump over. And I'll just do this one the intended way. Right, this one is a little bit tricky because you need to have this platform like this. Then press the wrong button. I can still make it. Yeah. Press A to do the handstand while pressing down. Press B to grab an item. Remember that, Treeks. I still gained from this level. Died once, but I got two up back. That's what I'd like to see. Alright, this is where I'm going to stop for now. I did the very complete part of the original game, which is just World Zero in this game. It only consists out of four levels. And almost completely did level... or World 1. Here we go again. Level, stage, world, course, platforming... mechanics and platforming name giving for the levels always trip me up, so forgive me if I do that again for the rest of my life. Anyway, thanks for watching. I hope people get a good nostalgia trip from this game or never actually seen this. Yeah, well, this is what platforming was on the Game Boy in 1994. Puzzle platforming, even better for some people at least. But still, I will see you next time. Freaks out.